What's up, everyone? Super Nerd Daniel here once again. You know, honestly, I don't know why I haven't talked about The Legend of Zelda more on this channel, aside from a couple of videos in the past. It's one of my favorite video game franchises, and hell, the Triforce and the Master Sword are part of my character art, so I definitely need to do an episode of the What If series about it, just to rectify my neglect. The Legend of Zelda series has always featured games with dramatic boss battles, interesting puzzles, epic plots, amazing music, and they're generally just a lot of fun to play. Hey, no, Steve, get that off the screen, all right? We do not talk about the CDI games. Those do not exist. At any rate, you know the drill. It's time to take five characters from across the franchise and give them four Pokemon apiece, as I tell you what I think it'd be like if characters from The Legend of Zelda were Pokemon trainers. One of the most consistent things throughout the entire Zelda franchise is its focus on a mythical, all-powerful artifact known as the Triforce, and the characters who wield its three pieces, the Triforce of Power, Wisdom, and Courage. The person who can combine all the Triforce fragments and wield the complete Triforce is said to be given unimaginable power over the land of Hyrule, and that's usually the end goal for the series' most prominent antagonist, Ganondorf. Born to the otherwise all-female Gerudo people, Ganondorf is one of three central characters in the Zelda franchise who exist across multiple generations, but is typically depicted as being devious, greedy, manipulative, and power-hungry. A lot of the games center around Ganondorf's attempts to rule over Hyrule by any means necessary, no matter who tries to get in his way, even if they're a child, and as seen in the Ocarina of Time, a world ruled by a man dubbed the Great King of Evil is about as well off as Pride Rock when Scar took over. Which is to say, not at all. To start off Ganondorf's Pokemon team, we'll be giving him a Spirit Tomb, a Pokemon composed of 108 wicked souls, to represent his unapologetically evil nature. Next up, a Miss Magius, to represent Ganondorf's adept magical abilities, not to mention his tendency to use said magic to curse those who cross him or get in his way. Next, and this one's more of just an aesthetic pick, but I'm gonna give him an Ember, because in the earliest Zelda games, Ganondorf was merely known as Ganon and was depicted as more of a pig-like monster, and Ember is basically a dead ringer for that original character design. And lastly, I'll be giving each of the three holders of the Triforce pieces of Pokemon capable of Mega Evolution, one I feel is best suited to the fragment they usually have in the game, so in Ganondorf's case, that'll be a Mega Garchomp, not only to represent Ganondorf's origins as being one of the desert-dwelling Gerudos, but also, upon Mega Evolving, Garchomp gains a staggering amount of power in exchange for some of its speed, perfectly captured in the differences between his normal form and his Ganon form in games like the Ocarina of Time. I mean, come on, let's be real here. He had to have sacrificed some speed in order to let Link constantly get behind him and stab him in the tail, right? As long as we're talking about characters driven by greed, why not include the Happy Mask Salesman in this video, eh? The Happy Mask Salesman may only appear in three games, that being the Ocarina of Time, Majora's Mask, and Oracle of Ages, but he's gained a reputation amongst the fanbase as one of the most enigmatic and rather unnerving characters in the whole Zelda universe. Usually sporting a calm, happy demeanor, he's prone to sudden, erratic outbursts of anger, especially when one of his masks goes missing or he doesn't receive the rupees for a mask you sell on his behalf, and he's also been shown to have a strange collection of powers with very little explanation, including teleportation, vanishing out of sight, and the oddly specific power of being able to make a giant piano appear out of nowhere. I mean, I don't know about you, but that'd be one hell of a power for me to have to impress people at dinner parties. Anyway, it was kind of difficult to really cultivate the Happy Mask Salesman's Pokemon team, since there's not really any real backstory to go on aside from vague clues about his motivations and the fan theories that sprang from them. So, admittedly, I gave him a Meowth and a Sableye, both for pretty much the same reason, Pokemon that represent greed and a love of money, something that the salesman definitely has in spades. Next up, a Yamask, which again might be too obvious a pick, but given that it's the only Pokemon in the franchise that basically deals with physical masks, I think it's a good aesthetic pick. And lastly, let's give the Happy Mask Salesman a Banette, a Pokemon driven by deep-seated grudges. I think this might be the best Pokemon to represent the salesman's angry outbursts whenever things don't go as planned. Not to mention that a ghost type could be good for representing his otherwise unexplained ability to kinda just go where and when he wants to at will. Then again, if you're like me, you've probably just accepted the idea that the Happy Mask Salesman is merely the in-game avatar of Shigeru Miyamoto. I mean, come on, you can't tell me the salesman just happens to have all this weirdly specific knowledge about Link and the world at large, and just so happens to be aware of Link's time traveling in Majora's Mask, and just so happens to have a mask of Super Mario's face on his backpack. The Happy Mask Salesman is a Miyamoto self-insert confirmed. Going back to the holders of the Triforce, next up, let's take a look at the Princess of Hyrule and the namesake of the game series, Princess Zelda. Zelda, like Ganondorf before her, exists across multiple generations and timelines, but is often depicted as being wise, kind, and benevolent. No surprise, given that she's typically the holder of the Triforce of Wisdom. Of course, just because she's not the protagonist of the game series, despite the fact that it's called The Legend of Zelda, she's anything but the damsel in distress. Zelda's been shown many times to be more than capable of defending herself quite nicely in the heat of battle, and Link honestly would have been screwed more times than one had it not been for some timely magical aid from the princess. Let's start off Zelda's team with a Gardevoir, a Pokemon that not only fits the princess aesthetic quite nicely, but is known to be extremely loyal to those it cares about, to the point of being self-sacrificing. Next up, to represent most Zelda incarnations' inherent powers of precognition, we'll be going with both Gothitelle, a Pokemon who can predict the future based on the placement and movement of stars, and Espeon, a Pokemon who can predict the opponent's next move by reading air currents. Also, Espeon typically being a good screen setter could work quite nicely for Zelda's own abilities to create magical barriers. And lastly, like Ganondorf, she too will have a Mega Evolution to represent her wielding the Triforce of Wisdom, so let's go with Mega Alakazam, a Pokemon with such tremendous psychic powers that merely glancing at a person could give it knowledge of that person's entire lifespan, from birth to death. Honestly, I hope that only includes the one canon death at the natural end of my lifespan and, you know, not the thousand or so other deaths I went through trying to get through the water temple. I'm just saying, that might be a lot to take in. You know, we've touched on how certain characters exist across multiple games and multiple generations, but there's one character who shares this trait that I find extremely fascinating, that being the Hero Shade. Though he only appears, at least in this incarnation, in Twilight Princess, fans of some of the older Zelda games have already met him and played as him. You see, according to the Hyrule Historia, the book officially detailing the timeline of the Zelda series up until Skyward Sword, it's revealed that the Hero Shade is, in fact, a past incarnation of Link, specifically the Hero of Time, the Link seen in Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask. See, the Hero Shade was once a great hero in the land of Hyrule and a celebrated swordsman who saved the world time and again, but after death, he came to be full of regret and lament, believing that he wouldn't truly be remembered as a hero and being unable to pass his skills down to the next generation. However, upon meeting the Link of Twilight Princess, the Shade is able to ease that guilt somewhat by teaching this new Link many powerful skills and techniques, finally being able to truly lay himself to rest with the knowledge that he's given his skills to the next great hero. Obviously, given that he's a past incarnation of Link, we have to give the Hero Shade an Aegislash, given his role in Twilight Princess is mostly to teach various sword techniques to the new Link. Next up, Lycanroc, specifically Dusk Form, to represent the golden wolf form that the Hero Shade takes outside of the ghostly ether, similar to the wolf form that Link himself often takes in the game's story. After that, and I think it might be cheating slightly, but let's give the Hero Shade a Kyurem. I think it's fair to give a once legendary hero a legendary Pokemon, not to mention that Kyurem is actually a perfect fit, given that Kyurem itself is essentially just an empty vessel, a hollow shell of a once legendary beast guided by a great hero of truth and ideals. And last, but certainly not least, a Yamask, but for far different reasons than I gave one to the Happy Mask Salesman. See, the Salesman's Yamask was pretty much just because, lol, masked, am I right, but Yamask's actual Pokedex entry is why I gave it to the Shade. Yamask lives a life full of regret and longing, looking at the mask of its former face and its human life and weeping over what it lost and what it could have still had. This encapsulates the Hero Shade to a T because, despite all of his efforts and his courageous deeds, the Hero Shade died with a heart full of regrets, believing that he had not truly set his legend in stone for the future generations of heroes. I mean, that, and he probably also regrets all those water temple deaths. Yeah, you bet your sweet bibby I made a water temple is hard joke twice in the same video. Big whoop, you wanna fight about it? And last, but definitely not least, we can't complete the video without the hero of the franchise, the wielder of the Blade of Evil's Bane, the holder of the Triforce of Courage, Link. Much like Ganondorf and Zelda, Link exists across many generations and many incarnations, but is always shown to be extremely brave and determined. He's willing to fight ferocious monsters, scale the highest mountains, fight horrid creatures in graveyards, and even to get through that goddamn stupid fucking water temple, all to bring peace and prosperity prosperity to the land. Armed with courage, dexterity, wisdom, power, agility, and compassion, Link is the hero we need and the one that we deserve. And what great hero would be complete without his weapon? An Aegis Slash, specifically, an obvious choice to represent the Master Sword and the Hylian Shield that he's most often depicted with. Next up, to represent Link's adept archery skills, let's give him a Decidueye.
A Pokemon said to be able to nail a small pebble with a single arrow from 100 yards away.
After that, to represent his beloved horse, Epona, let's give Link a Rapidash. Now, I did consider Mudsdale for this slot, mostly because it just looks more like Epona than Rapidash does, but Rapidash boasts a way higher speed stat than Mudsdale, so I just thought it was a better fit for Link. And lastly, for his Triforce Justified Mega Evolution, we're gonna go with Mega Gallade, a master of courtesy and swordsmanship that uses its elbow blades as weapons to protect those that it cares about. Now, as usual with these what-if videos, I know there are gonna be some picks that people don't agree with, and if you're one of those folks who thinks I picked a Pokemon for someone that's way out of line, then my only real response to that is...
Well, excuse me, princess.
Oh, come on, it's a Zelda video. You know I had to shoehorn in that meme at least once. So, what do you guys think? What Pokemon do you think the characters from the Zelda games would have on their teams? Let me know in the comments below! Give this video a like if you liked it, and subscribe for more powerful, wise, and courageous videos like this in the future! See you next time, Pokemon trainers! Super Nerd Daniel, out!